an Arabian alliance between Ishmael and Esau. And there's prophetic word about them in their hostility towards Israel and Christ that will go all the way to the second coming. So these passages that we're studying are prophetic, and they're very good. And, you know, I feel like we ought to really understand this from a biblical perspective of what's going on in our news. And this is part one of the history of the Edomites. Esau is going to become a nation called Edom, the Edomites. That is their first title as a nation in history. So here we are, we're in verse 39 and 40, and Isaac, Rebekah has just had twins, Esau and Jacob, and Esau has given the rights to the Abrahamic covenant to Jacob, and now is giving Esau his. Isaac, his father, verse 39, answered and said to him, "Behold, away from the fertility of the earth shall be your dwelling, away from the dew of heaven from above." In other words, he's going to be sent to a desolate place. "By your sword you shall live," because you won't get it from the land. Later they'll get it from oil, but until they got it from oil, they used the sword. Their history is a history of warfare and violence. "By your sword you shall live, and your brother you shall serve," that is Jacob or Israel. "But it shall come about when you become restless that you shall break his yoke from your neck." Okay? That's the prophecy of the Edomite part as a nation. Ishmael is given the covenant, a covenant. God gave him a covenant. And Esau, he's given the rights to become a nation. And they'll become that. They won't be able to do it. They will do it with the sword. They still, warfare is their first choice now. Oil has tempered some of that, but it's also financed some of it. But warfare, that's what their key is, and God has put them in a desolate land. And so before we start study, be sure your cell phones are off. That gives classroom etiquette so we don't have distractions in this hour of study. And then the second thing is personal. I mean, here we are Tuesday night, and I know you've had a busy day, and I know probably you've struggled through it and got here, and God bless you for that. Be sure that you're spiritual. You can't study the Bible and get truth from it in carnality. Evidence of carnality in your life, as I tell you often, is personal sin. Mental attitudes, sins, or sins, overt sins, or mental attitude, sins of the tongue, that type of thing. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess it, this is the key to the ministry of the Holy Spirit to get spiritual. You got to study the Bible spiritually and carnally. Carnal, evidence of carnal is personal sin. You confess that, 1 John 1:9, confess your sins. He's faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. I mean, I'll tell you why that's important, because if you go, I might hear people say this to me, "Well, Ron, I have no idea how many sins I've committed. I ain't even thought about them until I got here tonight." I've said, well, pause for a moment, reflect on your life, and whatever one the Lord says, poop, here's one. You need one, I got one, here's one. I've kept up with them today. You haven't, but I have. Here's one. When you confess it, it takes care of all of them. Puts you back into spirituality. See, if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So that's a, you know, God's ahead of us. He's one step ahead of us, which is a good thing, isn't it? Most of those days we're one step behind, aren't we? I've had one of those days. I just, one step behind. Until about morning. I was really doing good. From 4 on, I couldn't go back to sleep. And so I've been one step behind all day long because, right, we've all had those days, haven't we? Yeah. So if I fall asleep up here, just somebody take over and say amen and close it down and go home, okay? But anyhow, let's have that prayer. So those are with us tonight in our study hour, both by automobile and by internet. We ask you to pause a moment and reflect upon your priesthood responsibilities in Bible study. 1 Peter 2 tells you you're a believer priest in the church age. Every believer is a priest. And it's your priestly responsibility to be a spiritual person when the Word of God is open and you have the opportunity to study it and learn from it so that you can teach other people. And, I mean, first to yourself and then to others. And so I give you a moment of, you know, that examination of responsibility of confession of sin if necessary. Otherwise, just push life and pray for Bible study tonight that you at least panic when you hear the 6 o'clock news. So, Father, we're thankful tonight for these that have come our way both by automobile and internet. And we pray, Father, that this hour would we would cut off the distractions from our life, the small voice of God that can speak loudly through the ministry of the Holy Spirit to our life, would speak truth into it that would set us free from the cosmic system like Jesus said in John 8:32. You'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. How true that is. So we pray for that tonight as we look at the history of the Edomites, part one. Show us, Father, the prophetic historical part of that, because we're close to it, because we're close to the second coming, the imminence of your return. So here we are, Father, and we pray that we might see this with clarity, that we might understand what's going on in the world, and especially why Israel is this little tiny nation and yet has such hostility towards it. And because of our identity with them, there's hostility towards us. May we be strong in that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the history of the Edomites, this is part one with it, but the history of the Edomites is a perpetual struggle against the idea of the supremacy of Israel in the plan of God. And the supremacy of Israel in the plan of God isn't Israel. It's who Israel is supposed to represent in the person of Jesus Christ. It wasn't Abraham. It was the seed of Abraham of Galatians 3:16 that would be the Savior of the world, and that's the key. But it's a perpetual struggle over the supremacy of Israel. And they don't understand it's not Israel. Israel represents both the first and second coming of Christ. And I think sometimes the church forgets that. I don't think they forget that Christ is coming again. I think sometimes they fail to see the players that are going to be involved in it on earth when he comes back. Well, anyhow, it's interesting because in this prophecy, you're going to see that it's going to be a cyclic struggle. They're going to be a servant of Israel. They're going to have to do business with Israel. They're going to have to do business with them. They're going to have to coexist to coexist. You can see that struggle they have with it over there, the Arabs and the Israelites. But they don't like servitude to Israel. They don't like the idea that Israel has a supreme position over them. But they do, and so the cycle is they go into servitude, they rebel. At some point in their history, they revolt. They want to be free from that. And they revolt, they become free for a while, and then they go back to servitude because God says that's the way it's going to be. That's just the way it's going to be. So they go out, they come back, they stay there a while. Now, a lot of history passes through this cyclic, but I'm saying if you study the Edomite history, this is their history. They're into servitude. In other words, Israel seems to be in a supreme position. Nobody understands it's God. Sometimes they think it's military. Sometimes they think it's this. You know, if I just had to bomb, I could do this or that. But listen, if you had to bomb, all you could do is eat it. Because this thing runs on the plan of God. It doesn't run on human ingenuity or brilliance or warfare or any of that. But anyhow, so their struggle is a hostility struggle, and it's a cyclic struggle. And if you study their history, you can really see this, if you study this history. So then they wind up back under the supremacy of Israel because Israel has connections and things like that. America has been a great ally to Israel. At one point, almost somebody throughout the whole Europe system were allies to Israel because they studied the Bible. The Bible was the central book of their history. And all those nations, they were allies until America came along, and we just took over that responsibility, and everybody left. As they left, we filled that gap. And we have held that gap throughout our history. Rightly so. And because of America's strength, we've been able to pull a lot of allies out of Europe that still believe in the Bible to some degree. Those people that believe in the Bible to some degree, we've been able to pull them back into allies with us because they understand our mission with Israel in the plan of God. So this has been kind of an interesting history for us in America. When you look at this passage, the writer of Hebrews says something interesting, and I wrote it down because I think it's so interesting. Hebrews 11 and Romans 9 talk about Esau in a historical, prophetic way. They're really interesting. I want to bring a reference to you from Hebrews 11:20. John says this. This passage connects all of this history to Christ, because Hebrews 11 is all about Christ. I mean, what is the faith? What's the center? Ours is it. The central theme of the Old Testament was Jesus Christ. The central theme of the New Testament, Jesus Christ, that's always been the central theme. Central theme of every dispensation that exists as the divine agency of God, custodians of the word in evangelism. Well, here's what it says in Hebrews 11:20. It says, by faith, Isaac blessed Jacob. Now, if you want to study that, I put it on your paper. That's Genesis 27:27 through 29. Isaac blesses Jacob, and that's a blessing that goes to the Abrahamic covenant, and he blessed Esau. See, by faith Jacob blessed Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau. See that? For Esau to really get this, so far they haven't. But for them to get it, they've got to understand how God can turn cursing to blessings, and the only way he can ever do that is in Jesus Christ. Come on now. In other words, if you look at their prophecy, it's called a blessing. The only way it's a blessing is for them to understand that the central theme, only way you can turn God's cursing into God's blessing is through Jesus Christ. So if there's any Arabs out there listening to me anywhere today in the world, and there are, they give us a heads up every once to John, then you need to understand we welcome you to come on in. Because this train is going to pull out before all hell breaks loose on earth, and you could be on that train. Let me tell you something better than 70 virgins is Jesus Christ and heaven. The 70 virgins is in hell. I know you may not like that, but that's just the way it is. I could soft sell it, I suppose, but I don't know how to do that. So, but you see, when you read Esau, the only part of this that has anything, I mean, you're going to go to a land that can produce you nothing. You're going to have to live on that land. You're not going to have any other land. That land is yours. And listen, later he's going to say, I declare to everybody that this land that I'm going to give him, Mount Seir, it belongs to him. That's his land. Now, it's a worthless piece of land. Later, God is going to let him get a drill on it and go like, whoo. But it's a worthless piece of land as far as agriculture. And that's prophetic. He says that right here. And you're going to have to live by the sword. He says that. He said in our passage, and you're going to have to live by the sword. But listen, you're missing the point, and that's because I'm not getting there well enough. In Hebrews 11, chapter verse 20, it says, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau. But you see, the only way that happens, the only way you can turn curse into blessing is through Christ. It's the only way. It's true in your life, too. It's the only way. Now, watch this. Watch what he says, and he by faith blessed Jacob and Esau. Listen, even regarding things to come. See, we call that eschatology in theology. We like those big words, so you know we make more money when we talk that way. Give you those big words, eschatology, things to come. That's the end times. Things to come. And see, the Hebrews, this is a Christian book that connects the Old Testament to the New Testament in the person of Jesus Christ. Hooah. And so any Arabs out there that would like to get on the good gospel train that's going to pull out of here when Jesus comes back in the air, come to understand that the central theme of the blessing given to you by Isaac is to come to Christ and have the cursing turn to blessing. And you can do that if you believe that Jesus died for your sins and was buried and raised from the dead the third day. You can get that. Not complicated. Romans 1:16 says, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. You got to believe that Jesus came into this world to die for you. He didn't come into this world to die. He came into this world to die for you. Yeah, because we're all sinners. We're all sinners. It doesn't matter. And listen, there's a great passage for those who might be listening with us for the first time on the internet. There's a passage for you. It doesn't matter whether you're a Jew or Arab or a Shawangabara. It doesn't matter. Look. In Galatians, the third chapter, listen to what he says. Listen to what he says. Starting with verse 26. You are all sons of God. Not all sons of God. You are sons of somebody. And probably other people got names for you too. Listen. My God, through faith in Jesus Christ. For all of you who were baptized into Christ, that's positional truth. See, well, the wonderful thing about positional truth, it takes you from a place of cursing and puts you in a place of blessings, and a place of blessings that you never, not one curse, when you're removed from the place of curse to the place of blessing, not one of those curses can touch you again. See, that's saved by grace through faith and not of yourself as a gift of God. Oh, well, he says, you were baptized into Christ, that's positional. Have clothed yourself with Christ. See, that's the whole purpose. The whole purpose in being saved, baptized into Christ, the whole idea is so that you can be clothed with Christ. And then he says, here's the benefit. Let me tell you the benefit. Let me tell you what you can take to the bank that make you happy. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Hoo-ah. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring and heir to the promise. You can get into the promise of the Abrahamic covenant, which is Jesus Christ. Now, see, for an Arab, you don't have to become a Jew. You have to become a Christian. The Jew doesn't have to become an Arab. He has to become a Christian. You have to be in Christ, and when you're in Christ, you have a new identity. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things become new. That's wonderful. That's true if you're an American. It's true, right? If you're Jew or Gentile, Gentile picks up everybody out there. Male or female. Well, the history of the Edomites, I'm going to do two studies on it. One tonight, introduction of the history, and then I'm going to go into it next week with you, if you've got the courage to come back. We're going to look at six aspects. First, because it's so important to 6 o'clock news right now, in my opinion. At least it's important to me. So, examine the prophecy of history recorded in 40. I want to important. This is, they're going to walk this out in history. This is a prophecy that they're going to walk out in history. And listen, one of the most interesting studies at the time. I mean, I can't do it tonight, and I can't do it next week either, because it's just, but you ought to see the role that the Edomites play walking this out in the history of the Testament. The history of them in their connection to Israel is picked up when Israel makes the journey of the Exodus. That's where you find, this is when this prophecy begins to kick in. And then you watch it march its way all the way out to the present day. The Old Testament, but a lot of times you see these words like the Edomites and the Amorites, and you just think they're a bunch of ites, and you don't, what have these people got to do with anything? And they have a lot to do. In fact, some of these people have survived all the way down to today, like the Israelites and the Arabs. They're still here. They're going to be here after America isn't. They're still going to be here. They're going to be here after the church is gone. They're still going to be here. That is pretty heavy stuff. So here's four things in the prophecy, just breaking them down for you. Their land would not be prosperous. That's 27:39. You can read more about it in the 36th chapter, 8 and 9. I put that on your paper. In Joshua 24, now we're in the Exodus, and we're in the distribution of the lands. Israel is going to have to contend with them. And in Joshua 24:4, God is going to say, to Esau I gave Mount Seir to possess. And it's right on the king's highway out of Egypt to the promised land. And they get there in good traveling, and they stand out with bayonets drawn and said, you're not going any farther. And so they had to take another route, Okay. 27:40, they will have to live by the sword, because their land is not prosperous, right? No prosperity. not going to get any egg rolls. Listen, they're going to have to use the sword just to get food. I mean, now Esau was a hunter, so he'll hunt till there's nothing left. You know, you can only hunt them so long. If you kill everything that reproduces, you're done there. Right? Well, anyhow. Third, their history will be a cyclic struggle of servitude with Israel. They'll really fight that. They're fighting it now. And listen, some of the fight is settlements and all that kind of stuff. It's just interesting. This is still playing out just prophetically. The fourth and final thing, there would be times when they would be motivated towards freedom, and it would usually occur. This is so important, and this is the great history as you study it, working out. And it's usually going to occur when God puts Israel under divine discipline. They will form an alliance with whatever nation wants to conquer Israel. They'll form an alliance with them in a heartbeat. And you'll see them all the way through history do that. All the way to the Babylonian captivity. It's just interesting history. And the reason that all is working out is because of this prophecy that you don't think is important. Say, now, I don't mean that you don't. I'm just saying that people don't, you know, you don't hunt people. This is not one of their five favorite verses. And let me share my favorite verse with you. Say, I've never heard anybody quote that to me. Well, anyhow. Not even a Jew. The second thing is the descendants of Esau became known as a nation as the Edomites. Edomites. And the reason they were called Edomites is because Esau sold his birthrights. And let me tell you where the word came from. You remember he sold it for lentil soup. Called red lentil stew. Red. And I wrote, did I write that word on your paper?
Yes, you did.
Well, see, in Hebrew you read from the right to the left. So you got an E-D-O-M. See that? Well, that's what that is, see? That's what that is. Okay? So that's where the word Edom came from. Isn't that interesting? Now, listen, they're 400 years into their life. They become a nation because they were promised they would become a nation, right? It was given to Rebekah. You have twins, and there'll be two nations, and they were in a struggle. Remember that? We've studied all that part to get to where we are. Well, they're going to become a nation. They're going to become a nation, and when they do, they're not going to call themselves. Well, I don't even know how you would say descendants of Esau. So, wouldn't you like to have been sitting around the table when they said, what are we going to call ourselves as a nation? You know, business people in business said that, what should we call ourselves and what kind of a tag should we have? We had that problem as a church. What are we going to call ourselves? We called ourselves all kinds of things. Everybody else was too, though. So, but wouldn't you like to have been a little mouse? Well, not a mouse because they'd have ate you, but that'd have been meat. But wouldn't you like to have been able to eavesdrop on that? I said, well, what are we doing? What are we doing? What did you do? And somebody, some historian like Kirk Kniep, sitting in there, and he said, well, let me tell you something about the background. Let's call them Edom because of red, they sold the birthrights. Oh, that's a pleasant thought. This whole thing went, hey, why did they say, here's my buddy, why did they say when something's going bad that it's gone south? That just really irritates me. But the truth of things were going bad when I came south in my life. And things really got turned around because of Jesus Christ. So it kind of irritates me when I hear people say, that something went bad, they say, well, it went south. I even catch myself every once in a while saying it, and then I go like, quit that. Quit saying that. Only good things come out of the south, man. Quit saying that. Well, anyhow, the third thing is something I think is interesting for us today. Here's something interesting for us today. The Mosaic Law, see, only a guy like me would even pay attention to this stuff. The Mosaic Law allowed the third generation of the Edomites and the Egyptians, and the scripture tells you why, to become incorporated into Israel. See, you had to be in Israel for three generations to be able to become a citizen. And if you were a Moabite or an Ammonite, you couldn't get in until the 10th generation. You can read about that in Deuteronomy 23:7 through 8. 3 through 8 would cover the whole thing. And who are the Moabites and the Ammonites? Lot's children. Lot's children. And you know, when you look on a map, and you got the river down here, and you got the Dead Sea, right? You got the Sea of Galilee up there. Then you got the Jordan. Jordan, you know. Don't you want to sing when you hear Jordan, especially somebody with a deep voice? Here you got the Dead Sea, and here's what you got, and rightly so. These are the groups that ought to be around the Dead Sea. But this up here, you got the Ammonites and the Moabites, and down there you got the Edomites. That's why they were going to travel in there, and they stopped them. Wouldn't let them travel. Dead Sea, that's where these guys are located. And this was the land out of Mount Seir. This was the land that was going to be given them by the Lord. You know, in the back of your Bible, you have maps, don't you? Well, you want to look at it. Not now. Don't look now. But later, look at it and go to the map where it talks about the Exodus journey. And you will see that. That's where you'll find that. On your map. So the spiritual freedom part of their existence would only come. And you know what's interesting? Ishmael was given a covenant. Esau is given rights to a nation. You know what the devil knows they lack? Scriptures. They need a Bible. And along comes one who develops a Bible with enough stories from the true Bible to give it some ump. And when they get that, they are now arrested. They're considered one of the three major religions in the world. Do you know who's up there with them? Israel, Judaism as a world religion, and Christianity. Now, there are a lot of religions. But this group of people was able to take themselves out of cursing and blessings. But God would do that. But listen, they didn't choose Christ. They were an idolatrous and heathenistic people. To survive, they had to come up with their Bible. And they got one. They got one. And that one there has a few of the stories twisted to their way. They got enough stories in there that stupid Christians don't know better. Christians that don't study their Bible, they're hoodwinked by all that craziness. Devil knows how to manipulate and control. Well, anyhow, that's just... talk about the angelic convoy. He set them up, boy. He really set them up. And listen, he did the same with the Samaritans, but the Samaritans got converted. They threw their book away. The Arabs still got theirs. And buddy, they're running through the streets with it. They are running through the streets with it. And when they get to your block, they will burn your Bible. The first thing they'll burn is your Bible. after they kill your children in front of you. Or burn your Bible. Like that's going to somehow fix their curse. Well, anyhow. The prophecy of Edomites, that is through Esau, the prophecy of the Edomite hostility towards Israel or Jacob would be passed down through generations of descendants until the second coming of Christ. You can deal with these people. Listen, when the church is gone, this thing will kick into gear during the tribulation and it will be a mess. You talk about a war. This will be a war among wars. One historical example of fulfillment of the prophecy of hostility was Edom's refusal to allow the Exodus generation to pass through their land in Numbers 20. And be well worth your time to study that on your own. They put up a detour sign, buddy. Israel was just moving right down the king's highway. And they called it, when they hit there, they went, there's no king highway here. No Israelite's going to go through our area on the king's highway. This is detour highway. You're not going through. Listen, this is 400 years after this whole thing started. Well over 400 years. Here's another one. I'm going to jump ahead. I'm going to jump from the Exodus, where they're now a nation. I'm going to jump ahead and jump all the way to the Babylonian captivity when you connect up with guys like Obadiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel and that group. Listen, in Ezekiel gave a prophetic reference to them in Ezekiel 35. The entire chapter is devoted to the Edomites. And he winds up this chapter devoted to them because they formed an alliance against Israel. He says, Ezekiel says they're going to once again go into desolation. And it's interesting that word desolation because of how it's connected to the second coming. And he winds up saying, listen, I want you to know something. I'm the Lord whether you acknowledge it or not. I am the Lord. I'm the Lord when you say I'm not, I don't exist, I am the Lord. And when you call the Lord something else, I'm still the Lord. Well, anyhow. And the little book of Obadiah, you probably don't pay any attention to the book of Obadiah. You've probably read through the Bible and skipped it. You know, I read through the Bible in a year, somebody will say to me, and I said, well, boy, wasn't the Obadiah good? And they didn't even know where it was. So, and I know that. I mean, I know that. I just playing with them. But Obadiah, the whole book of Obadiah is about this. I say the whole book. I mean, if you had two pages stick together, you'd be through Obadiah. But Obadiah is really interesting. And really, if you really want to know what Ezekiel's prophesying here about the Edomites, and you should care about it because it's playing out in history. Then you turn to Obadiah, and Obadiah just goes through it, man. But yeah. Yeah. That one through, yeah, I know. That's 1 through 15. I don't know what the 1-1, that's an emergency call, apparently. It's 1 through 15. It's chapter 35, 1 through 5. And what Ezekiel says is that the Edomites who enter an alliance with Babylon against Israel will be disciplined for it. I mean, boy, you talk about heaping it on you. I mean, they're already under a curse. And he said, listen, you do that, I'm going to kick you to the other side of the yard. And boy, did he. The principle. Here's a principle for us, because your eyes are starting to glaze over. God is not indifferent to the 6 o'clock news. God is not indifferent to what is happening in the world as it relates to the plan of God. He is not indifferent to it. Where was God when it came through? And where was God? Where was God? Where he's always been. Where he's always been. The problem is you don't know anything about him because you reject Christ, and you'll never get to know anything about God until you come to the place where Christ is your Savior. Then God is your Father. Until then, he's not even a buddy. Well, yeah. For the Christians, you see, that's helpful to know that because it gives us comfort with a passage like Romans 8:28. God works all things together for good. I mean, we believe that about everything. Well, I read the 6 o'clock news. I thought, well, thank God that God's in control of all this mess. Right? And I feel that way in my personal life when things just get going nutty. I thank God that he is the God of order when there's disorder in my life. When I'm going like, what's this and how is that and what's this, and I get one more phone call, what is this and what is that? I go, whoa, wait a minute. What are you doing? Stop. God has all this in control. What are you fretting about? You know? And it's comforting me to when I get that way. You know, I need another cup of coffee. Oh, I shouldn't have drunk that much. Right? It's good to remember, wait a minute. You're not here. Listen, you just take care of your little 6 feet. Don't worry about this other stuff. And you just handle what you can handle and quit worrying about what you can't handle. God don't give you more than you can handle. And listen, he's got this under control. Yes, but what about the kids? And what about the grandkids? And what about this? And what about that? Shut up a moment. You're talking so much, I can't hear the still small voice of God. I don't know if God talks that way to us, but I know I talk that way to myself. I'm trying not to talk that way to other people, but God allows the Edomites to participate in the divine discipline of the fifth on Judah, and a good example of that is the Babylonian captivity. And boy, these guys are mentioned all over these prophets that had to deal with that. It's just an interesting study for those who like history. I know there's some of you that really like it. This would be an interesting study for you. I'm telling you, it's a big one. Now, finally, tonight, the Edomites were primarily heathenistic and idolatrous people. The devil set them up to give them a corrupt Bible. He set them up. Heathenistic, you reject the gospel of Jesus Christ. You substitute idols for God and a whole system of worship. Then he brings a guy along and he sits down and writes you a theological book. You call it your Bible. It takes about 3 generations to get there, but first thing you know, they are. What a mess. Now we got people run down the street with that Bible in one hand and sword in the other, just like God said they would. And now they're killing us because we don't believe in their God, which does not exist, by the way. Sure, not my God. The God they're talking about is not mine. Not mine. They're a heathen. Listen, the only way you get to my God is through his son, Jesus Christ. And, you know, the Israelites are no better. The Israelites are no better. They carry this Bible around, reject the supreme central issue in it. The Jews are no different than they are. They got a Bible without Christ. Not picking on anybody. You need Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, I don't care where you come from. I don't care what your ethnic background is. You need Jesus Christ. You need the gospel to save your soul. Anyway. Here's an interesting passage for you to study. 2 Chronicles, it's on your paper, chapter 25, You want to read 14 through 15 and 20. And I think if you read those three, you'll read more. I gave you the juice. You know, I always try to pick out this stuff. I think, well, if they get read that, they're going to run and read more. Okay? I don't know if that happens, but. And you're going to meet a guy there who is the king of Judah. You're going to meet a guy in this passage, and that's why I hope you want to read more about him. And he wages war against the Edomites. He defeats them. And the spoils of warfare that he wanted, he took. Their idols and their heathenistic stuff, took them back and worshipped them. So I guess you know the worms are going to eat him too. Can you believe that? Hebrews, the 12th chapter, verse 11, listen to this one. Now I'm in the book of Hebrews. You say, oh, we finally got to a book I'm familiar with. Hebrews, the 12th chapter. Single meal. He sold God out for a bowl of soup. Threw him under the bus for a bowl of soup. Must have been good. Huh? Just think how long that bowl lasts. Huh? This was a guy who hunted and did everything outdoors. He was an outdoorsman guy. You know that bowl of soup was gone before about an hour. And he's back in trouble, wasn't he? They lived in sharp contrast to Israel's faith in God through Christ. A strong pivot of believers carried the plan of God from Abraham to Jesus Christ. It wasn't all of Israel, was it? No, it was a strong pivot, though. Israel, if they'd brought it, they'd still have him. They kicked him out of Israel, too. Put him on a cross and kicked him out. They've never let Jesus back into Israel. They've let some of our missionaries. They don't let him back. He's not part of their central part of their nation. We got to watch it. It used to be a central part of ours, not a central part of ours either. We throw them under a bus. We need to get that back. I heard more about Jesus Christ during this inauguration than I've heard in a long, long time. Whew. Come pray for that. Give us more of that stuff. Then a strong pivot of disciples of Jesus Christ, listen to me, this is what we miss sometimes, carried out of Israel and into the world. And Rome comes in and really sacks them. But, you know, they fulfilled that, marching it right across the world in Acts 1:8. Romans, the 9th chapter, 7 and 8 says, nor are they all children because they are Abraham's descendants. I mean, out of Abraham, listen, we've got the children of Keturah. We've got the children of Sarah. We got the children of Hagar. We've got all kinds of people out of Abraham. Only one falls in the lineage of Christ. The people, when you read something like this, people don't not familiar with the Bible, they don't know how many children Abraham fathered that weren't under the covenant. Just saying. You read the genealogy of Matthew 1 and the genealogy of Luke 3, and you get you know where it went. Who were the covenant people? But through Isaac your descendants will be named. That is, not the children of the flesh who are children of God, but the children of promise are regarded as the descendants. In other words, the seed of Christ. Let me conclude this lesson with one final example of the hostility of the Edomites against the Israelites and Jesus Christ, with Herod the Great. Herod the Great was an Edomite. Herod the Great was an Edomite. Now, here's what's interesting. Herod goes in. He wants to, listen, he's going to kill the king of the Jews. The Magi come in, king of the Jews. He wants to kill the king of the Jews. The baby, he knows he's a baby. He knows he's under the age of two. He knows he's not. He's over one and under two. So that's why he healed everybody under two. So, but, and you know, and there's a, but here's what people miss. Then they start crying. And they don't read the, but what, business, the fifth cycle. Book of Obadiah and things like that. This is the connection of the Edomites with the Babylonian captivity. He connects. Listen, Matthew connected him back up in the killing of the babes to destroy Christ. He's an Edomite. See, we miss that in all of that historical play is missed in that. I mean, it's such a dark scene, isn't it? That we just kind of shut the book and pause a moment and don't look for the light in it of the theology or the prophecy that's connected. He gives us a prophetic word, and sometimes we miss it. And then if we do get it, we read it, and it don't make any sense because we can't connect it historically. And so what I'm trying to do with you tonight is to connect some of these dots historically, because they're playing out in our 6 o'clock news right now on national news. So it's well worth your time to look at that stuff, okay? Let me have a word of prayer. We'll let our internet people, and then we'll go into our private prayer time as a church body for personal needs. Okay, let's pause for a moment. Let's pause. Our Heavenly Father, we're thankful tonight that once again you've took us into history, and sometimes history, when it's not connected to our nation and stuff, can get difficult to stay with it. And I pray, Father, the Holy Spirit will be able to make the connections enough to draw an interest that we might understand how this is playing out in our everyday news. And our whole security system of interest today in America, and the money and everything we're spending and our thinking is towards this enemy. And trying to bring that into some relevance and try to bring it into some curious thinking. And then to offer our Arab friends that opportunity to come into the kingdom. We invite you to come in to the kingdom. Jesus Christ welcomes you. He went to the cross and died for you. Didn't die just for the Jew. Didn't die just for the Americans. He died for all people. For all has sinned and come short of the glory of God. We welcome you today to come and understand the simplicity of what you have to do to be saved is simply this. Believe that Jesus died on that cross for you. He was buried and raised from the dead. When you die, you will go to heaven to be with Christ. And if you don't die, he will return and you will be translated in a split second of time into that resurrection. I know that sounds probably way out there. But I know the Holy Spirit can convict you to show you the way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. There's no other way to God except through me. I am the Son of the Father. Like you think you're the son of Abraham. I'm the son of God Almighty. You can't get to him without me. Abraham had to come to me to get it there. Galatians 3:8. So, Father, we pray for that tonight in Jesus' name. Amen.